Welcome. So for our first discussion, I'm going to give you a little bit of an introduction about the design and development process, because it's kind of important to understand what we're talking about and what are the boundaries of what we're talking about. So let's go ahead and start to look at the phase from research to development, and that's really what we're talking about here. Most people, when they think of research and development, they kind of miss the integral piece. And so instead of just saying that, we could have what we call RTD, or we have basic research, which stands for R. And this is the whole discovery process. The time limits are kind of fuzzy because you're really trying to do some exploration as to what's going on. You're not quite sure what the return is in the early research. This is really a long-term phase, long-term thinking of what we're going to develop in the technology space. Now, when we're talking about products or in companies, it's a little bit shorter term than it is, say, in the academic environment, because you're really trying to target something that's gonna have an effect in a space. What do we mean by that? Like a market or an industry or a wicked problem that we're trying to solve. We're really trying to get into that specific area where we have some needs or some areas where we're identifying those needs. And research can be anything from the technical research, but it can also be the market research, things like that. The other aspect, when we move on from there, is how do we then transition from that basic research to product development? Well, usually, if we're talking about the technology world, which we are, there's some innovations in technology that have to be done. It's not that you just go from, hey, we have this great idea, we did some experiments, and suddenly we've got a product. No, there's usually a development process between those two things, and this is where the technology development dives in. It's not quite as structured as it is in final product. It is a little bit difficult to plan, but not impossible to plan. So usually you're looking at identifying what are the technologies that we need so that we can have the product that's going to fulfill the requirements by the customer. So those are the things we're looking at. It's not as predictable, again, as already established markets with established products and just iterating a product. And so it's kind of a medium-term arena that we play with. Finally, what we're ultimately trying to get to is a technology or service that is a product that somebody can use. And this is the development stage, because now we're taking it out of the prototype world and we're taking it into the practical world. So we got to think of things like manufacturing, we got to think of things like supply chains, we got to think of how we're going to deliver, how we're going to service, all those types of aspects on that end. So there's very structured methods on doing that, some planned timing with a predictable outcome and goal. Now, predictable relative to the market, what we think is going to happen. So it's much shorter term process, and that's what you usually see with a lot of companies. In this process, we have to think about, okay, how does innovation happen within, say, a corporate structure or even a startup structure? And really, it comes down to something I like to call the innovation village. Now, when you look at this, if you notice, there's something like a team lead. Now, that could be a CEO if we're talking about something that's a very small company, a startup, if you will. And they may have different types of groups around them. So typically there's some type of marketing professional, there's an industrial designer that isn't necessarily part of the core team. They do show at the core team here. Sometimes that's something where they get a consultant for those types of things. Same with mechanical engineers, electronics engineers. If they're part of the core team, then here they call them designers, which they are, but usually you just call them engineers. And that's for an electromechanical system. Usually some type of physical widget. Purchasing specialist, that's not quite the best term for it. That's the term they're using in the book. But somebody who can handle kind of accounting is probably a better way to look at that. And again, that could be somebody in-house or something that you specialize out. And then, of course, we come full circle back to manufacturing. Now, if you're looking at this, what do you suppose is really missing that would bring this diagram more into the 21st century? Because when you're kind of going through this concept, you see mechanical designer, electronics designer, industrial designer. They're really kind of missing a key element that is part of many, many technology companies in today. And what's really missing is the software piece, which is usually integral to having the mechanical and the electronic systems working together. Because oftentimes you got to have the hardware talking with the software and everything to work in unison. So software is really what's missing out of this. And typically in any type of company, you want to have a software lead that will also have a whole bunch of software developers underneath that realm. So without going too much further into it, this is in general what you're going to see in most technology companies, which again we call Innovation Village. Now, the other thing that you're looking at is the different factors of how does your product and or service or whatever it is that you're designing fit within the dimensions of competition. So you're constantly balancing things, right? You're balancing what's our manufacturing costs, what's our quality, and how can we leverage, you know, lower costs but still maintain high quality. And you have to be very careful about that, because if you drive down costs too much, quality oftentimes is sacrificed. So be cognizant of that, because if what you're touting in the marketplace is that your quality is going to be better than your competitor, you don't want to be cutting costs to the point where it's really not. That can really bite you in the butt. On the flip side, we also have product development. And in this case, this is where we've done lots of research on what the customer needs are and converting those customer needs into what are features and functions, and really how the product has to operate or work. What are the necessary items? What are the nice to haves? That's good to know, but what are the gotta haves? The things that the customers absolutely need to be able to sell this product and use this product. So competitiveness is very important based upon these things. So it kind of brings up an idea though. There's some people that say, well, you gotta pay attention to your competitors. That's true, but more often than not, particularly if you look at a lot of the entrepreneurs of today, they say, you know what, don't focus on your competitors. The problem is because then you stare at your competitors and look at what they're doing. That becomes a real issue, because if that's all you're doing, you're not paying attention to creating value. And really, we want to create value. And how do we do that? It's through the product development. And it's about the product or service experience. So I want you to think for an example, what is a product or service that you've encountered where you had an absolute horrible experience? Maybe the product was poor. What happened in that experience? Did it not work? Did it fall apart? Did it just not have a good look or feel? Everybody can kind of think of something where they've had a product that they thought was going to be great, but they just had a really poor experience with that product. So that's one side of the coin. Always think about your product from your customer's point of view. And we're going to talk a lot more about that as we move forward. But that gives you a sense of, it's not just, does the product do the function? A lot of engineers get hung up on, does it just do the function? That becomes a problem, because you're really missing the whole other side of the boat of, how do people experience your product? How does it make them feel? And oftentimes that's not something that engineers like to think about, but it's actually very salient to the conversation. And if you go back to thinking about a product that you really had a rough time with, would you ever go purchase one again? That's kind of your telltale sign. If you would never purchase that same product because you had a horrible experience with it, that's not good for the company. It's not going to last. So versus, now think of a product or service where you had a fantastic experience, where it was great, you just love using the product. What did they get right in that product or service that made it feel that way? Or was it their service that made you feel like, you know what, they're really taking care of me? Even when things don't go perfect, I feel like the company really has their customer's best interest in mind. So those are things you want to think about in creating the whole value, not just in the design of the product or service itself, but everything that surrounds it. Okay, and there's other classes where we dive into more about that whole surrounding piece. Let's look at some examples now. So for example, most people can see this. I probably didn't even have to put the name Apple on top for you to know that this is the company Apple. So looking at these products, now we've got several different products, right? So we've got their laptop on top. We have an iPad, an iPod, or iPhone these days. And if you just have the look and feel, you can almost aesthetically tell that it's an Apple product, even without having to read it. So that's serious industrial design work and serious branding. They have spent decades building that image into something that is identifiable without you having to even know what the name is. So these intangible elements drive a lot of the success of Apple products. Very few products do you see other people lined up around the bend to get the new version of something. So that's something that is kind of a unique thing that you see with Apple. It'll be interesting to see in the future if they can maintain that. So other types of products that have a certain look and feel. Black & Decker. Now, this is completely technology in the other landscape of hardware. But Black & Decker, if you look at their logo and look at the colors they use, they actually have threaded their color schemes throughout their product lines. So if you look at it, here we've got this orange and black theme that goes across almost all of their products. So it's something that's very familiar. And it creates the signature look of these types of products. The other thing for products like this is there's probably much more of a functional expectation. They've kind of built their brand on these products are hardy, you can drop them, they'll keep working, you can use them in difficult situations, and they're easy to use. So there's a lot of things they built in here that are very different than from, say, the Apple products, where we're really looking for a rugged system. And then we have other types of things. So it's not just about ruggedness, it may be about innovativeness. So this is called the Good Grips Angled Measuring Cup. And as you can see, it's a measuring cup that you can look at from the side. So you don't have to, how many of you have ever had to hold up a measuring cup and you're like trying to line yourself right with the line to see if you're actually there? Now, us as engineers, we like to do that sort of thing. My wife just laughs at me when I sit there and I try to line something up. She's like, you don't need to know it that well. But hence, that's the problem if you have all of your scale on the side. Where here, if you notice, they have this horseshoe type innovation where you can actually see it from the top. So you don't have to do your guesswork from the side. So it actually was driven by customer feedback. So this is where the customer redefined the design and they made something more elegant and different. So it embodied a differentiation in this product that you don't see in other things. And people might be willing to pay more for this than a standard measuring cup. So let's take a different example. Here's something that's functionally different. Now, at first blush, this Target prescription pill bottle seems kind of odd. So what are some of the first things you notice about it? Well, maybe one of the first things you might notice is it looks like it's upside down. And you'd be right. But from the feedback they got from a lot of customers, particularly older patients, this was actually preferable. The other thing is they made the lid much wider with the ability to be able to open it. Much easier, because particularly when you're talking about people with some extreme arthritis, that can be a problem. The other thing is they wanted to make a surface so that you could easily read the pill bottles. So the problem with some of the small ones is people can't read them and they can't figure out what the dosage or how often they have to take it. So they tried to change that and make it readily visible as to what the medicine is, so you know what you're taking and then how often you need to take it. The other thing they did, if you notice, you can see the little patient info card. You can actually pull that out so you can read the rest of the information that you need to know in much larger font than how it is on a normal like pill bottle. So there's a lot of innovations in this design. And of course, Target did put a little branding on here by having kind of the red container and those types of things. So there's a lot of thought that went into the redesign of this prescription bottle. Now, how does that functional difference look from a design like this? In this case, if you look at this, it's called the Bodum Pavina glass, and most of us probably don't even have one. What does this tell you? What do you kind of get from this type of a design? So it's very different. If you notice, we're not going for massive function improvement or anything like this. This is called design of elegance and design of aesthetic. And this is much more an industrial design component. In this, you're looking for simplicity and elegance and just something that is almost like a work of art to look at. And that's kind of what they're going for here. So it's kind of a unique look and feel, and it distinguishes their glasses from all the other glasses out there. So in this case, people might be willing to pay a little more for this unique looking glass and unique style of glass. And finally, we get things like function. And again, this is going back the other way. Here, what's the value proposition? Why would I buy a robot to vacuum my carpet? Well, if you're the person who normally has to clean your floors and clean the carpets. Maybe you're really sick of doing that and you have to do it often, or you have pets and it's like a daily routine. They have to sweep up things. So this actually can do that for you. So the value proposition is it doing some work for you that otherwise you would have to do and saving you time. So the value here is the time saved by you not having to do that. And so this is a technology company again. So it's a way they were able to take something in robotics and apply it to everyday use. And this isn't the only one. This is just really one of the first ones from iRobot that really came about. Okay, so really what we're looking at is a whole bunch of different topics. Now the textbook that we're using has massive amount of topics, way more topics than we can go through. So what we're really gonna focus on is the ones that are in yellow as we move through. We have other courses that cover some of these other aspects, but for this course, this is really what we're gonna focus on in TEM 250. So with that, we will explore the next chapter in the next video. Thank you for watching. Take care.